Good afternoon, all. Hello, God bless everybody that's focused on serving Jesus Christ. And those of you who are not yet focused on serving Jesus Christ, may the God of creation open your mind and inspire you to serve Him, because otherwise nothing is going to make sense and you're going to find yourself in a really, really bad way in the near future. Thanks everybody for connecting with us and joining with us. Hopefully today finds you safe and prepared to go forward, because you know growth is intentional. Growth is something that we have to intentionally undertake. You have to in order to grow, you have to try to grow. You have to be mindful of the importance of growth in order to experience growth. God bless you, Brother Renaud. God bless you, Brother Tyrone, Brother George, Brother Joseph. Okay, so today we're going to be talking about a few things, and we're going to see just how far we can get with today's talk. Yesterday, earlier in the morning, or earlier this morning, we were talking about some of the mentalities that can destroy our lives, and those mentalities, I used the Dr. Seuss books, a couple of Dr. Seuss books, to illustrate the mentalities that we fall prey to, which are temptation-based. And you know, temptation, whenever you're being tempted, what's happening is you're being lured from a place of safety. You're being lured from a place of identity. God bless you, Brother Chavis. So understand this, that when the devil is tempting you, he's luring you away from your true identity. That's his goal. That's his agenda. His agenda is to ruin your fellowship with God by stealing you from God's presence. Because guess what? You were created in the image of God. Now, briefly, how do you think someone would act if you treated them like an animal? If you treated people like an animal, do you think that they'd act in a positive way? Do you think that they would act in a good way or in a bad way? The likelihood is, if I treated you like an animal, you'd act in a combative way. You'd be angry with me. You'd say, David, how dare you treat me in an inhumane way? But you know, that's what atheism teaches us. Atheism teaches us that we're animals. You understand that? Atheism teaches us that we're animals. God bless you, Brother Will. And listen, man, Brother Will, you know, like, if you can't view it, don't forget now, it's on here, so you can go back and check it out. But atheism teaches us that we're animals. Now, if that's what they're doing, if they're telling you that you're an animal, it's because they're trying to steal your identity. It's a lie of the devils. The devils tell us that we're animals, and we'd rather believe that. Many people would rather believe that than to obey the loving God, the God that loves them and sent his son to die for them. So don't forget that you're not an animal. We're not going to forfeit the good things of God because the world is afraid of you and I recognizing that we're the real sons of God, and we start positioning ourselves as such. Okay, so let's talk about this. So the first thing we're going to talk about in today's broadcast is how God wants us to be committed and a faithful people in order to represent him. Now I'm going to base this off of Psalm 50 verses 16 and 17. It says, "But to the wicked God says, what have you to do to declare my statutes, or that you should take my covenant in your mouth, seeing you hate instruction and cast my words behind you?" So the Lord in the book of Psalms obviously covers a bunch of topics, but in Psalm 50, he talks about the importance of faithfulness to him and how he doesn't necessarily enjoy the sacrifices that we give in and of itself. God doesn't necessarily enjoy David clapping his hands or going to church and extending my arms, just like you wouldn't enjoy a woman. If you're a man and someone married you, you got married, you wouldn't enjoy a wife who in your presence was all lovey-dovey and affectionate, but once she left your presence, she was flirtatious with every male that she encountered. You wouldn't enjoy that kind of a relationship. You'd take her ring from her. Like, listen, woman, if you're only going to be affectionate when you're in my presence, then we're not going to have a relationship. You wouldn't do that. Now, please, tell me you wouldn't do that. Tell me you wouldn't. You wouldn't do that. You would not allow any person that is supposed to be exclusively committed to you, you would not allow them when they're apart from you, when they're separate from you, you wouldn't let them act in a disloyal way, because there's a certain nature to this relationship. So in your relationship with God, there's a nature to it. There are specific aspects of your relationship with God, one of which is exclusivity, meaning you don't belong to God and the devil. Once you tell the Lord that you want access to him, then guess what? You forfeit access to everybody else. When you get married, all of your ex-girlfriends, ex-boyfriends, they become off limits. You can no longer try to investigate how they're doing. That's off limits now. You can't call them every now and then to see how everything's going, because maybe you two were friends before you were dating. That stops. You shouldn't have been out there trying to pick and choose like a bee from one flower to the next, pollinating this and pollinating that, you know, the birds and the bees. That's not something that God wants for us. God's not okay with that. So once we tell the Lord, yes, I want commitment. Yes, I want the benefit of being a child of God. Yes, I want the Lord. At that point, God says, well, guess what? I wanted you first. Okay, so once you give your heart to the Lord, understand the Lord wanted you first. It's him. It's he who motivated you. He was the one that was attracting you in the first place. Jesus said, you haven't chosen me, but I chose you. Now, he wasn't simply saying that to his disciples. He was saying that in an existential way. He was saying that from the outside, from an eternal perspective, in an eternal way, God chose humanity because God created man. He made man to look like himself, to act like himself. He gave us this animate life. We're lively, we're functional. Okay, so God is the one that gave us this life, and he gave us all the benefits of this life. He allowed us to be tempted as mankind. We failed the test, and so now we have what we have. But even now, the presence of God is working in our lives to bring us back to him in a better way than we ever had access to him before. And so one of the things that we have to understand is that if you're going to represent God, or if you're going to benefit from the presence of God in your life, then there are expectations of faithfulness that God has for our lives. So the Lord loves you. God bless you, Sister Rosalind. So the Lord loves us and wants us to be faithful to him in order for us to represent him. In the same way that our wedding rings represent our marriages, that's all that this piece of jewelry does. It just represents that we're married. In the same way that our wedding rings, for those of you that wear them, represent your marriage, in that same way, your life of obedience to your father, your faithfulness, it represents your covenant, your commitment. God wants you to live a committed life. God bless you, Sister Angela. So the Lord loves you and wants you to live a committed life, because if we benefit from our fellowship with him, then he wants us to represent him well. When you work at certain grocery stores, they don't allow you to walk in there in a scruffy way. They don't want the facial hair here. Certain places make you put hair nets on. So I've seen places where they make the men put hairnets on their beard. Why? Because they're saying that we represent a clean and a hygienic environment. And in this hygienic environment, we try to keep all things, all debris. We try to keep our products debris free. So they want their customers, when this store, Sam's Club, when Sam's Club says, come and buy our products. And some of our products are made fresh and preserved fresh right behind the counter. They want every patron to come into that store and get the impression that they're concerned about the well-being, the health of their clientele. So there are very many companies, depending on the types of responsibilities or the type of product that the company sells, there are very many companies that are strict concerning dress code, concerning how you carry yourself. Obviously, other companies, again, depending on what they do, are going to be more lax. But specifically, we know that the companies that are making the most money, they're the people that represent those companies. There's a code of conduct that you have to maintain in order for them to pay you the big bucks. If you want to make the big bucks, there's a code of conduct. Even if you want to make any bucks, there's a measure of faithfulness. There's a measure of responsibility that you have. So there's a measure of responsibility that you have. Chavis is saying that they do that at his job. You've got to have beard nets because you're dealing with people's food. God, because he gives you and I access to people's hearts by the Spirit, God's going to tell you things about people in dreams. God's going to give you open visions about people. He's going to allow you to perceive things about people. He's going to show you secrets of his. And if he does that, when he does that, as he does that, he wants you and I to grow in love. And a part of love says that we're going to do what God expects of us according to the teachings and the behavior of Jesus Christ. So Jesus teaches us, and he acted in a way that was recorded for you and I to know what we should do, so that as the Spirit of God is working in our hearts, working in our minds, we have a reference. We have the scriptures. We don't guess about the works of Jesus. We don't assume what Jesus would do. No, we're able to review the record of what he actually said and what he actually did, and how the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the Father, the Spirit of Jesus Christ, how the Holy Spirit works in man today. That's what the book of Acts is about. That's what the book of Revelation also gets into, the expectations of God. In Psalm 50, it's talking about how God wants us, if we're going to benefit from being sons of God, we've got to represent him well. We've got to represent him. Jesus is the expressed image of the Godhead. So Father, Son, and Holy Ghost can be seen clearly in the person of Jesus. The scripture says we have to walk worthy of the calling wherewith we are called. So guess what? God loves you and has called you to a position where he wants to reward you. We have to respect the fact that God loves us enough to desire to reward us. God wants to reward you. God sees you. He understands that you've been through a lot. He knows that the world that's around you is chaotic and dangerous, and he doesn't want you in it like it is. He wants to give you glory. The Bible talks about the glory that will be revealed in us. God wants to give you glory. God wants to give you status. God wants to make you mighty in the earth. He wants you to be more than a conqueror, no matter what's going on around you. But he wants to give it to those of us that are absolutely submitted to him. The scripture says, submit yourselves to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. The scripture says, delight yourself in the law of the Lord, and he'll give you the desires of your heart. The word of God says, his expectation for you is one of great hope. He says, I know the thoughts that I think toward you, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end, or an end that is full of hope. And then he goes on to say, and you will call upon me and you'll find me, and I'll be found of you. I'll come to you. I'll manifest myself to you when you've sought me, as you seek me with all of your heart. So guess what? The Spirit of God wants you to understand. He wants you to understand that what he has for you is accessible, but you have to submit to the likeness. You got to submit to the likeness of the Lord Jesus Christ. You've got to give yourself to God. You've got to give yourself to God, and he's going to transform you. Now God is not unfaithful. He's not unrighteous to forget your work. That's one of the things we have to respect. God is not unrighteous to forget your work. God is not like a company. You know how certain companies might give you more responsibilities but not pay you for it. The Spirit of God is not that way. Every area of your life that you allow God to change, in every area of your life that you submit to God, there's a benefit from it that you stand to gain. You stand to gain from. In my relationship with my wife, one of the scarier aspects of marriage is the fear of being changed. The fear that your relationship with your spouse is going to absolve you of all identity, all originality. You're about to lose yourself in this marriage because this person wants you to change in so many different areas. And many of the fights that we had, my wife and I, or many of the arguments that we had, were based on the fear of being changed. The fear of being changed. I didn't want to change. She didn't want to change, right? But I began to learn year after year, the closer I got to the Lord Jesus, the more I realized that change was good for me. See, pride tells me I don't need to change, but the closer I got to the Spirit of God, the more I realized that change was good for me. Every area in which I was required to change, when I changed, it didn't just benefit me in my marriage, it benefited me in my fellowship with God. I would hear my wife complain about aspects of my character, and I'd question whether she was telling the truth or being biased. I'd seek the Lord, and when the Lord would allow me to realize that, hey David, her complaints about you are my complaints about you. So the things my wife was complaining about, the things she'd complain about, these were indictments that God had. David, your wife is saying that you don't spend time with her, but guess what? You don't spend time with me. Your wife is saying that you're not intentional enough in your relationship with her, but guess what, David? You're not intentional in your relationship with me. And so I began to realize that the more faithful I was in my relationship with my wife, because I recognized by grace, God gave me the grace to recognize that, you know, these areas of your life are bigger than just your marriage. It's about who you are. It's about what's coming out of your heart. It's about what's coming out of your heart. David, you're selfish. And you think you know who you are. You think you came into this world perfect. You think that you're perfect. You're not. So the Holy Ghost has to break down various aspects of our personality and show us that without growth, we're unacceptable. Meditate on that parable that Jesus gave, where a man has a marriage for his son. He sends out the servants and he's inviting everybody. Most of the people decline. I'm not coming. I'm not going. And then he sends the servants out again and he says, well, you know what? Get the untouchables. Get those that are poor. Get the blind. Get those who are missing body parts. Bring them in. apparently at some point there was a transition. There was supposed to be something that occurred to where they were going to divest themselves of their own garment, their own garb, their own image. At some point, they were supposed to have gotten new clothing, which represents a new identity. Okay, so the Lord will get you no matter how raggedy you are. But at some point, there's a point of transition. At some point, there's transition. At some point, there's change, there's transformation that's required. Now, there's an instantaneous transformation, and then there's the transformation that we undergo throughout the rest of our lives. But it starts with being born again. So the Lord invites these people in. They come in. Then the ruler of the house goes and greets the guests. As he goes and greets the guests, he sees a man that doesn't have a wedding garment on. Remember, that garment represents his identity. He sees the guy and he says, "Friend, how did you get in here without having a wedding garment on? This is a banquet. You were privileged enough to be invited. Why didn't you submit to the image that we were trying to maintain here?" And then he tells others of his servants, "Tie this guy up and throw him into outer darkness, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth." We know that that's symbolic of hell. So the point is, you can come as you are, but you can't stay as you are in order to stay. In order to stay, in order to represent Jesus, it doesn't matter that you're a rapper. It doesn't matter that you're a Muslim. It doesn't matter that you're a Buddhist. It doesn't matter that you're Hindu. It doesn't matter that you're a rapist. It doesn't matter that you're a murderer. Come as a murderer. Come as a liar. Come as an extortioner. Come as a thief. Come as you are. Meet Jesus, because that is the cataclysmic, the confrontational meeting where the Spirit of God meets man and there is change. We see that change is violent. We can see that by the death of the cross. Jesus didn't get poisoned for our sins. Jesus didn't die of old age for our sins. Jesus was violently murdered. Because the change that God expects of us is a violent one. Now, fortunately for us, it only manifests as us confessing our sins and we feel the change. We feel the lifting off of the burden of sin and rebellion. But we have to respect the fact that for Jesus Christ himself, in order to get you, it was violent. And when the Holy Ghost does enter, when the Spirit of God enters, one of the first things he confronts, as Jesus teaches it in John chapter 16, is sin. The Holy Ghost comes to confront and correct us about sin. And you can admit, if you've been walking with the Lord, that your encountering of God and you're having to have dealt with various entrenched sinful characteristics, you can admit that there were fights between you and God concerning what you'd give up and what you'd not, what you'd hold on to and what you'd surrender. So God bless you, Sister Claudette. So one of the things that we have to understand is that change oftentimes is very heavily resisted. We resist that change because we feel like we're going to lose ourselves. We feel like we're going to lose ourselves. But guess what? That's why Jesus bought you. He bought you because he had a better idea of who you are, much better than who you think you are. Who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? How impressed are you with you? How impressed are you with you? One of the reasons why God has to say, in Psalm 50, to the wicked, "What are you doing preaching for me? What are you doing talking about my word? What are you doing talking about my truth?" Brother Chavis and I were talking recently about the difficulty that we're facing on social media, and not just on social media, but obviously, since we're on social media often doing gospel ministry, there's a difficulty in who gets to represent God. Because we all want to represent God, but we don't want to be changed. How can we want to represent God but not change? Explain how that works. So David likes green and black, or I like green. I like red and khaki. David likes red and khaki because I worked at Target for 7 years. Let's say that was true. So now I've transitioned from Target and now I'm at Walmart, and they don't let me wear the red and khaki anymore. They've got the Walmart that I work at now, the Walmart where I work, they now require the royal blue and khaki. They now require, or green and black, depending on whether it's a neighborhood store or whether it's a supercenter, fine. They now require a change, but I really got used to the red and khaki. I decorated my house with it. I bought a red and khaki car. I've got red and khaki sneakers. I feel like that's me. But I do want to work at Walmart, but I'm not a royal blue kind of guy. I'm a red kind of guy. That's the kind of guy that I am. And I want to bring that individuality, that uniqueness into the new company. I want to bring it into the new company. We have to ask ourselves, man, what right do you have to do that? What right do you have? You love Burger King. You grew up on Burger King commercials, but for your first job out of high school, you got a job with McDonald's, and you've got some suggestions because they allow the employees to put suggestions in the box. And so you put a suggestion in the box that says, you know, I really think that we should sell Whoppers because I think that the flame-broiled Whopper is a major point of attraction. I really think that we, Mickey D's, should sell Whoppers because I love them. I love Whoppers, and I love the crowns. I think that we should even give out Burger King crowns. Maybe we can just kind of, you know, go under the radar. I mean, we are a franchise. No, you can't come into the company and try to make the new company like the old company, especially as we're talking about the kingdom of God. Because the real issue is the company from which we come, the company of hell, that's where we came from. We came from the gates of hell. We were in bondage. We were slaves in Egypt. We were in bondage to the spirit of anger, to the spirit of lust, to the spirit of rebellion, to idolatry. We were in bondage to anger, rape, murder, sexual perversion. We were in bondage to that. The scripture says in 1 Corinthians 6 verse 9 that you can't inherit the kingdom of God with that behavior. So if we can't inherit the kingdom of God with that behavior, and our last video, what we were talking about was the fact that behavior is based on belief. So belief is the bedrock of behavior. It's the basis for behavior. So David is only going to do what David believes in. Now, I might not know all of what I believe because my heart is deceitful above all things. I don't know the full contents of my human heart. I don't know what's in here. I think I know, but when I'm in different situations, what I do, I need to watch myself. We're always talking about watching others. Hey, you need to watch him. You need to watch you. Jesus said, take heed to yourself. You need to know what's going on in you. You need to know. And sometimes you don't know, but you need to watch how you act. What thoughts enter your mind? What thoughts just pop into your mind when you're in certain environments? You need to know you because you need to know what you believe. If you don't know what you believe, then you're going to wrestle with God for who you should be. You're going to fight with God for who you should be because you're going to think quite much of yourself, and you're going to want to represent God in a ragtag way, in a ragged way. You're going to still have very clear worldly ways about you. You're going to still want to dress like a prostitute and represent Jesus. You're going to want to show your cleavage. You're going to want to show your thighs for the men. You're going to want to wear tight shirts and show everybody how bulk you are as you're out here evangelizing. You're going to want to Keep up with all of the styles. You're going to want, when they're wearing skinny jeans out there, you're going to want to wear skinny jeans because you like the style. You're still connected to it. You love the world. You love the brownness in your hair. You love the earring in the nose. You love it. You love the tattoos. You love the music. You want to Christianize everything. You want to make excuses for everything that you're, you love the culture. One of the things that we can't, that's so difficult for us to do, is to become divorced from the culture that's around us. We find that difficult to do because we are so in love with it. We spent our lives in the culture. It's all most of us know. It's what's familiar to us. And we want to represent God, yet we don't hate the world, meaning not the people, but the system, the culture. We don't hate it. We don't despise it. A part of us loves it. We love the fake hair, the fake eyelashes, the fake personalities, the aggression, the arrogance, the pride, the me first mentality. And then we try to justify it. But the Lord is questioning what right we have to speak on his behalf if we're going to be in disobedience. That's why he told the husband in the scriptures, he said, you better dwell with your wife according to knowledge, or else your prayers are going to be hindered. He's telling us you cannot serve God effectively, but yet you don't love your wife according to the standard. Because guess what? David didn't create husbands and wives. God decided what a husband would be. God decided what a wife would be. And he gives us the instructions as to how to handle marriage. What a husband should be. What a wife should be. The Lord determines how I act in my marriage. By the power of his word and by his spirit, he's transforming our personalities. And he tells us how we should act. He tells us who we should be. He tells us what humanity is. And he tells us what faith is. We don't get to remix faith. We don't get to customize faith. You don't have those kind of rights until you exhibit faithfulness. We do understand that the longer we're with him, we talked about this last night at church, the longer you're with a company and the more faithfulness and seriousness that you show, is the more privilege they're going to give you. They're going to promote you. They're going to give you keys. They're going to give you expectations. They're going to give you rewards. They're going to give you vacation time. You're going to be able to make your own schedule. You're going to be able to manage other people. You're going to be set as a good example. What's the point? In the kingdom of God, when we show faithfulness, when we show that we can manage things on a fundamental level, then God can give us more. So it's not that God doesn't want you to represent him right away on some level. God wants us to represent him as soon as we commit to him. But we have to respect the fact that just because Jesus found you that way doesn't mean that that's the you that he accepts. When we talk about Jesus saving us, Jesus buys a dilapidated house on land. That's what you and I were when Jesus found us. We were condemned housing, condemned apartment complexes. We were messed up. And the Lord Jesus purchased the land. And we thought we were kind of good. The Lord came and purchased this land. Obviously, we must be worth something. The Lord says, yes, I want to buy the whole property. And now I'm going to tear the structure down and I'm going to dig into the ground of this property and I'm going to build from sub-level upward. That's what the Spirit of God wants to do. And because he wants to build you high, he's got to dig down deep. That means he's got to get into the reasons why we are what we are. He's got to heal those things. And then as he's doing that, he's building upward. As he's doing that, we think we're kind of good. We think that we were actually pretty good. We think that we had a little bit wrong. We think, oh, I just had this and this and this. Jesus, if you can just take away my alcoholism. Jesus, if you can just take away my lying tongue. If you can take away my gambling hand. Jesus, if you can just take away my lustfulness. No! He says it's all bad. What do you mean it's all bad, Lord Jesus? My grandmother said I'm a nice person. Lord God, my boss thinks I'm the next best thing. You're not. That so when we When we misrepresent God, it's because we're in a tug of war. We're fighting with God for identity. We think we're hot when we're not. We think we're hot when we're not. People are always talking about haters. Some people are always talking about haters. That's irresponsible. That's irresponsible. You do more damage to your own self than any person could ever. So the only haters you should be concerned with is me, myself, and I. I'm not saying that people don't have enemies. We have enemies, man, for the gospel's sake. There are people that don't like us because we love Jesus. We're not here to emphasize, focus on, or highlight them. We're here to be changed. So the Lord doesn't want us to represent him if we're going to be willfully in rebellion to his expectations. If you and I are going to willfully rebel against the Lord Jesus Christ, he doesn't want us to represent him. He doesn't want us to represent him. That's true, Sister Angela. It does seem that many people do. Certain people have a fixation with haters. They got that from the world. So the Lord doesn't. So that's important. And the reason why that's an increasingly important message, you all, is because in our worldly culture, many of the celebrities are beginning to haphazardly represent Christian faith. Maybe when they get an award, when they do a song, but yet their hearts are separate from Jesus. That sets a bad precedent. There are people who have clean escaped from a life of rebellion. But in them, there's some desire to still listen to profane music. They just have no justification for it. And so when you have a godless actor who at some point begins to proclaim that he's a Christian, many people who are looking for a reason to listen to the godless music anyway are going to take that and say, you see, I knew that God was working on him. I felt it the whole time. I perceived it the whole time. And so I'm going to go out and buy his new album, or I'm going to download it. I'm going to download all of his movies because I knew that the Spirit of God was working with the guy from Breaking Bad. I knew that the Spirit of God was in full operation in Lady Gaga. And so I'm going to go and get all of her old music because it was the Lord the whole time. That's not the will of God. That's not the will of God. So we don't want to deceive ourselves, or we don't want to be deceived by those who haphazardly represent Jesus. Jesus said, either make the tree good and his fruit good, or make it evil. The Lord does want distinction. Brothers and sisters, please respect the fact that Jesus is fighting for you and I to be separate. Come out from among them and be you separate, and don't touch the unclean thing, and I will receive you, says the Lord. That's in 2 Corinthians 6. What fellowship does light have with darkness? All you that love the Lord hate evil, because Jesus loved righteousness and hated iniquity. His Father promoted him, anointed him with the oil of gladness above his fellows, above his peers. And so if we're going to represent Jesus Christ, understand that the Spirit of God does want us to be holy. He enables us to be holy. And so we approach him. We come boldly unto his throne to be made holy. We need to be sanctified of our personalities. Otherwise, we're going to misrepresent the Lord. You show up at a neighborhood Walmart and somebody behind the cash register is in full Target gear, full Target garb. They've got the name tag and everything. You're trying to figure out, are you in the Twilight Zone? Like, you're fearful. Should I give this person my money? What are you doing? Am I at Walmart? No, we can't do that, man. The guy is in full Pizza Hut gear. You're there at Chick-fil-A. Guy's got Pizza Hut all over himself. You're like, okay. Yeah, you'll be very confused when you're at the German car dealership and the guy's got the Toyota brand on his shirt. Okay, I didn't know. No, you'd be quite confused. So unless we're going to be faithful, we cannot represent God. We're going to bring confusion. We're going to confuse people. We're going to confuse them. And they're going to think it's okay to live a double life. Do not listen to anybody who presents themselves in that dual way. If it's a YouTube or Facebook ministry that, while sounds good, the person comes off in like they're worldly. I'm not saying if you got tattoos from before salvation that they're going to just absolutely disappear. We know it happens, but if it doesn't happen for you, hey man, you still got to preach the word of God. But what I am saying is the things that you can help, God expects you to represent him in word and action. And he'll speak through you very clearly. So that's that. Who gets to represent God? The faithful get to represent God. That's who get to represent God. And God enables us to be faithful. Jesus said, "Well done, you good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with little. I'll give you much." That's what God expects of us. Now let's talk about lifestyle. Okay, so there's a word. It's called, the word is conversation. In Psalm 50 down in, let's see where it is. It talks about ordering our conversation aright. Verse 23. Psalm 50 verse 23 says, "Whoever offers praise glorifies me, and him that orders his conversation aright, I will show the salvation of God." So let's talk about being mindful of what your lifestyle is. Whenever we use the term lifestyle, we're talking about decisions, okay? So your lifestyle, my lifestyle, comprises of a series of decisions that I make. That's what a lifestyle is. A lifestyle is the fulfillment, or when you take every decision that David is making and you combine it, now you can understand it as a lifestyle. So a lifestyle is that we want people to hear us. The word of God says, "He that wins souls is wise." So we want God to call us good and faithful. We want people to see our light. How can they see our light unless we shine? We've got to shine. The scripture proclaims, "Arise and shine, for your light is come." Have you been baptized in the Holy Spirit? If you've been baptized in the Holy Spirit, you know the Spirit of God is the essence of all things. He's the maker. He is the maker. He's brighter than the sun. And when he enters your inner spirit, he radiates through you. But he radiates through us as we agree with him. So how do we know that we're agreeing with God? Because our conversation or our lifestyle becomes a reflection of his teachings. That's how you and I know that we're sons of God. Our lives become a reflection of the things Jesus said and did. That means we begin to make decisions with Jesus in mind. The smallest decisions. We begin to make decisions. We begin to do what God tells us to do based on the leadership of his Holy Spirit according to his word. One of the reasons why we read the word of God is because as we read it and as we absorb that truth, we're being transformed. We are being transformed. This book has living records in it. This is not like any other document. This is not like any other record. This is living. The Spirit of God that spoke through these men is active. He's the one that keeps creation operational. He keeps creation in existence. And so your lifestyle, that's a series of decisions. What do you want God to record? What are we What do we want God to say about us when we stand before him? What do we want people to say about us? Yes, Romans 12:2. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then you'll be able to prove what's good, acceptable, and God's perfect will. So your lifestyle, when the scripture says, if you order your conversation aright, let's look at that word conversation. Now remember, God created everything with his words. Our lives are speaking, okay? Our lives are talking. Our lives are communicating to God, to the devils, to mankind, to creation. Our lives are communicating. Moses told the children of Israel, he said, and I'm not sure if it was Moses now, but I know either Moses or Joshua. No, it was also Moses. They told the children of Israel during their last address that heaven and earth was recording their decision making. He told them, he said, listen, heaven and earth is going to record. If you know what that is, put that in the text. I think I know it's in Deuteronomy somewhere, but it talks about I present to you this death. There it is right there. It's in Deuteronomy 30, verse 15 on down. Deuteronomy 30, verse 15 on down says, see, I have set before you this day life and good and death and evil, in that I command you this day to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commandments and his statutes and his judgments, that you may live and multiply. Don't we want to live and be productive? Don't we want to live and multiply? He's saying our lifestyles have to call for productivity. Our lifestyles have to attract goodness from God. How can David live a way? How can you and I live a way that attracts the goodness of God? He says we've got to first and foremost love God, because you're not going to obey a God that you don't love. You're not going to obey God if you don't love him. And that's intentional. Love is a choice. And with that come the feelings. Sometimes love is a feeling first, but it has to be backed up by choices. You can't say you love somebody just because you feel strongly about them, but yet that feeling hasn't transferred into action. And I can't simply have action without the feeling ever. I mean, what keeps me going is the inner motivation. God is love. And trust me, he is a consuming fire. So his feelings for us are quite strong. And so it says that obeying God is what will cause us to have a right conversation. He says, in that I command you this day to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, to keep his commandments and his statutes and his judgments for your benefit, that you may live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land where you go to possess it. But if your heart turn away so that you will not hear, but will be drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I denounce to you this day that you will surely perish and that you will not prolong your days upon that land where you go, where you pass over Jordan to go to possess it. Here it is. So Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 19 says this, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you as a reference that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life. Therefore, choose life that both you and your seed, your descendants may live, that you may love the Lord your God and that you may obey his voice and that you may cleave or unite or become one with him. For he is your life and the length of your days, that you may dwell in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob to give them. Guess what? God is your life. God is your lifestyle. God, the word of God says that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, he is the word. And so we operate by the word. We operate by the commands of God. That's how God becomes our life. How does God become your life? God becomes your life when you live according to his word. It's not empty conformity to routine or obedience. Don't think that. You're not a robot. You're not a drone. You're not a cyborg. You're not just following commands. There are benefits to your conformity. There are benefits to your fellowship with God. There are benefits to our obedience. God is not a God that says, do things, and then he not pay you for what you do. That's an analogy that I didn't complete earlier. God is not a God like our modern jobs where they tell us to do things and they don't pay us for it. They give us the responsibilities of a manager, but they pay us as though we just entered the company. They realize you're responsible, and so they give you responsibilities, although they don't want to pay you for it. God is not that way. Agreed, Sister Angela. What kind of relationship would you have if it was robotic anyway? So when God tells us to do things, he says that he's going to fill us. And so really, he's just trying to make more room for himself in our hearts and in our lives. And the last thing I want to talk about before we end the video is how relationships affect reputation. So let's talk about that, how relationships affect reputation. Your relationships are generally intentional. So we know that we've got parents and we couldn't choose them. We know we've got siblings biologically and we didn't choose them. But at some point, the older you get, the more control you get over your environment, or pseudo control that you gain over your environment, your relationships are intentional. Who are you going to spend time with? Who are you going to allow to influence you? Who you're going to intentionally influence? Who you're going to call an associate? Who you're going to call a friend? Who you're going to work with? To some degree, that becomes intentional. Since we've talked about how lifestyle is a group of decisions, we have to consider that our reputation hinges on the decisions that we make, and the people you surround yourself with, the people you surround yourself with, illustrates who you are. The people you surround yourself with speaks for who you are. Are you a good person or are you crazy? Some people enjoy the foolishness of their friends. Some people enjoy the mockery of their friends. Some people enjoy the craziness. Some people like the drama. They like the curiosity. They like the gossip. They like the hectic atmospheres. You are your friendships. You might not like that, but you are your friendships. There's a scripture in Proverbs. As a matter of fact, the very first chapter of Proverbs tells us something. I mean, we really didn't even have to go there. We could have just started with Psalm 1, where it talks about how blessed we'll be if we don't intentionally keep company with godless people. You know, there are people who have accepted the gospel of Jesus Christ, but they still enjoy the company of those who have not. They still enjoy the company of those that they knew while they were in rebellion. So you used to tattoo your body up, and now you've been convinced by the Spirit of God that since your body is not your own, you have no right to do that to it. And so you've broken all your blood covenants, which is what a tattoo is. It's a blood covenant. So you've broken that blood covenant with the spirits that motivated you to do that to your body. And now that that blood covenant has been broken by the power and blood of Jesus Christ, you're free. And those points of entry are now closed, because that's exactly what's going on with tattooing of our bodies. We're making blood covenants and we're exposing ourselves to the demonic. So once you come out of bondage to that, and now you want to live a life of godliness, decisions have to be made. And before elevation, or at least with elevation, or as you elevate, there comes separation. Meaning that there are certain people who do not represent what you represent. And you'll have to limit your exposure to them, because he that walks with wise men will be wise. So your reputation, it hinges on your relationships. Who you choose to befriend alters God's perspective of you. Who you befriend affects God's view of you. You might not like that as a reality, but it's not about what we like, right? David doesn't like the fact that if I drink this too fast, my body is going to push the water back out. If David might like the cool sensation that putting this bottle to my nose and pouring it, I might like that cool sensation. I might like the sensation of this going into my ear. My body doesn't. My body has been designed by God, and there are rules for operation. If I break those rules, my body is going to reject me. I'm going to start coughing wildly, sneezing. Pain is going to come about if I just pour this into my ear and it gets into the deeper canals. Pain is an indicator that rules have been broken. Pain is an indicator that standards have been lost. Rules have been broken. There's been pain is evidence of violation. Something's wrong. That's what pain is. Pain says, hey, violation, address it. That's what pain is. Pain tells us that. When you feel pain, that means something's been violated. A standard has been breached. So when the word of God says, he that walks with wise men will be wise, but a companion of fools will be destroyed. It says that in Proverbs chapter 14. It says that if he that walks with wise son will be wise. Where is that? Proverbs 14. Let's see where it is. He that walks with wise men will be wise, but a companion of fools will be destroyed. I can't find it, but it's in chapter 14 somewhere. Proverbs chapter 14. My eyes aren't catching it, but it's there. So if you want to be considered in the eyes of God and man, because one of the things that you have to respect is that God wants you to have favor with God and man. Jesus grew in favor with God and man. What about the people who say, well, Jesus congregated, Jesus associated with sinners. Jesus said, I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Jesus came to call sinners to repentance. So Jesus was intentional. Jesus was intentional about his relationships. Jesus didn't just befriend whomever. Jesus didn't just connect with whomever. Jesus understood that his reputation hinged on his relationships. I'll show you that. Jesus, in casting out devils, every now and then a demon spirit would try to speak and say, we know who you are, the Holy One of God. And Jesus would say, shut up, you're not allowed to speak. Jesus didn't want demons testifying of who he was. Jesus didn't want demon spirits testifying of who he was, because he didn't want anybody to, first of all, get any information about him from a demon. That goes back to what we were talking about earlier, how the Lord doesn't want those who aren't going to obey him to represent him. Relationships, when we're in relationships, we agree with each other. There's a measure of agreement.
And in that measure of agreement, we represent each other. See, relationships require agreement to be considered a relationship. For you and I to be in relationship together, there's a measure of agreement. There's a measure of loyalty that we have between each other. And so in that, I represent you to some degree and you represent me. If I use your services to some degree, I'm saying that you're valuable. I'm saying that you, that somebody should, I'm setting an example. I'm setting an example. So with that, who you choose to associate with, who you choose to allow to influence you, it's a life decision that affects how God sees you and it affects how man sees you. And you are ordained to grow in favor with God and man. I'll read the scripture here. It's in Proverbs chapter 14, verse 7. It says, go from the presence of a foolish man when you perceive not in him the lips of knowledge. Now, what happens if David does not go from the presence of a foolish man? What happens when David begins to enjoy the company of a foolish man? What happens when David enjoys the gossip? I enjoy the vain conversation. I enjoy that stuff. Then it's evident that that's who David is as well. David is that. What is it about David that is in agreement with this person, this thing? You understand? So we have to ask ourselves, who do we think we are? Who do you think you are? If you believe that you are a child of God, then there are certain expectations that are associated with that. Yes, evil communication, which is company as well, will corrupt good manners. So in the Proverbs, we see that the Lord is trying to steer us away from bad company because a little leaven leavens the whole lump. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. That was one of the things that motivated me to stop paying attention to secular media as far as entertainment. If I give my eyes to that and it's communicating an anti-Christian message, but somehow I find it funny or I find it amusing, I have to ask myself, what aspect of David finds this amusing? What aspect of David finds this funny? What aspect of David enjoys this conversation? So when we evaluate that, remember, because you don't know yourself as much as you think you know yourself. You don't know you as well as you'd like to think you know you. So that stated, you got to watch what you do when you're in certain situations. Because those involuntary thoughts that you have, that's you. That's the unregenerated you. That's the unregenerated you. That the you that just enters your mind and says, okay, yeah, this is who I am. When you're just in a circumstance, man, that's you. And so who you surround yourself with is evident of what's really, really going on in your heart. And so be mindful, guys, that we have, if we want to grow, if we think that we're sons of God, if we've been reborn by the Spirit of God, if we've submitted ourselves to God and we're born again, then we have to submit to the fact that that transition is going to affect who we can connect with. Okay? If you're going to be in fellowship with Jesus, then that's going to alter who else you can be friends with, who else you can connect with, who else you can associate with, because you don't want to be guilty in the eyes of God and man by association. And so that's it. That's basically all I have for you today. God bless you guys. May the Lord give you wisdom in all things. God willing, we'll talk soon.